All right, thank you, friend. You can keep putting things in the chat. Thank you very much. So I am so excited to welcome you to this presentation this evening by Dr. Randie Gottlieb. I can't remember how we met, but obviously we did meet and we hit it off right away. And she has such an enduring commitment to racial unity. And when I learned about her organization and all of the work that she's done, I've been waiting for her to come to present to us for over a year. And she's so busy. She's doing something every day, you know, on this. So I'd like to share with you briefly, you know, her bio, her very modest but intriguing bio. My goodness. We really have to sit down and have some coffee and chat about this fascinating life she's had. So she's the executive director and the founder of UnityWorks, which is a nonprofit organization committed to reducing prejudice and promoting understanding of the oneness of humanity, the value of diversity, and the need for unity, with a focus on K through 12 schools. She's been a teacher, a school principal, and college professor. She's authored 14 books. Wow. And holds degrees in education from Cal State. Hey, I'm a Cal State grad too, Boston University and Harvard. She has also been chased by street gangs in Morocco. She's worked as a child actor in Hollywood, played volleyball as a spiker on Team USA. She founded an elementary school in Puerto Rico, produced Spanish language community service radio and television programs, created Montessori math materials with the native Ngabi Bulge people in the jungles of Panama, and earned a bachelor's degree in wood design. With that, please help me welcome Dr. Randie Gottlieb. Randie? Can we get Randie on spotlight, please?
Thank you. Thank you, Sherlyn. Thank you so much for inviting me, and thank you also, Jillian and Nason, for helping make everything work here today. It's a pleasure to be here with you. I'm very excited. I'm thinking I'm supposed to push share screen now. Is that correct?
Yes, you can. Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you. And the music was absolutely, the music and devotions were absolutely beautiful. Thank you. Very inspiring. So apparently it did not work. Let me try that one more time.
We could see it, Randie.
Good. Oh, okay.
Yes. Yes, we saw it.
You see it now?
Yes.
Oh, okay. For some reason, it doesn't have that green outline around it that says you're sharing. Okay. I will
there
take
you
it.
Go.
And
okay.
Okay. So here we go. So I would like to begin with a land acknowledgement as well, a people acknowledgement, by acknowledging the people of the Yakima Nation here in Central Washington State, the original stewards of this land. And I would encourage you to be aware of Indigenous peoples and voices wherever you are as well. The topic today is teaching unity, educating school teachers about the oneness of humankind. And the goal of this effort is to help teachers, 80% in this country, 80% of whom are white, middle class, monolingual. And in Washington State, that number is 90% of teachers who are white, public school teachers. The goal is to help teachers move from the concept of humanity as separate races and from prejudices passed down for generations to the recognition that we are one human family, so that they in turn can share this understanding with their own students. And right now, as I'm sure everybody is aware, the entire country, the entire world is struggling with issues of race and diversity. And my thought is that learning about oneness, the oneness of humanity, should not be considered as an optional add-on to the curriculum. Rather, it's a critical part of the education of every student. So over the next 5 or 6 hours, I'd like to share a brief overview of some of the issues some common responses to diversity, some equity issues in our schools, and time will be short, so we won't be able to, this won't be thorough, but just to give an idea of some of the things that our schools are dealing with. The UnityWorks school program, some training topics and training activities that we do with the teachers and school administrators, a few highlights from the participating schools, and then this is the part that makes me the most excited, is teachers changing views on race. And then some diversity resources that we've produced in response to teachers saying, well, we know all the theories, you know, we've read all the research, but we want practical things that we can use tomorrow in our classroom with our students. And so we produced some of those as well. And then finally, some time for questions that you might have, takeaways. And then I have a couple of closing thoughts. So, Sherlyn, does that sound okay?
Yes, absolutely. This is, the floor is yours. And friends, the chat is off. We'll have time for discussion, you know, later on. And so save your questions.
Okay. So let me begin with the elephant in the room, or in this case, the elephant on the Zoom. And you may have noticed that I'm white. And I hear this as a diversity trainer. I hear this all the time. I hear, stop. Whites can't do this work. And you have no right to speak about prejudice. And my response to that is, racism is not a people of color issue any more than child abuse is a children's issue, or that domestic violence is a women's issue. It's a human issue that affects us all. And then they say, but you have all the power. And my response to that is, yes, I do have skin color privilege and power that goes with it. Would you rather that I use that to get more goodies for myself or to help bring about justice for us all? And then they say, but how can you possibly understand? And I say, you're right. I don't understand. I don't know what it's like to be Black or Brown in this society. I don't personally know the pain of stolen land. But I do know what it's like to lose a job because of my skin color and a business because of my nationality, to be marginalized for my religious faith and stereotyped for my ethnicity, and discriminated and discounted, discriminated against because of my sex, and I've been threatened with death for dating a man from another racial group. So no, I don't know what that feels like every day, but the little bit that I have experienced, I know that it hurts and that it's wrong. And those are human feelings. So how can I stand by and do nothing when this affects my brothers and sisters of color all the time, every second of every day? So my thought is, truth has no color. We all have a contribution to make and a role to play. So this is my story. This is the really short abbreviated version. These two got together and produced me. I had no choice as to whether I wanted to be Black or white, tall or short, male or female. They didn't even ask. And I suspect many of you had a similar experience. All four of my grandparents came to this country as young teenagers, refugees escaping persecution of the Jews in Eastern Europe. And that's another whole long story, which I won't share today. But that has definitely impacted my view of this topic as well. I grew up in a white middle-class suburb of Los Angeles, and this is my actual house, where everyone is the same color as me. Everyone was the same color. We all spoke the same language. We celebrated the same holidays. We shared similar political and religious beliefs. We had pretty similar family structure, economic level, and skin color. In school, we learned about white authors and inventors, white artists and musicians, white presidents and kings, and we didn't even notice that women and people of color were essentially absent from the curriculum. The world has obviously changed since I grew up. We've seen some major demographic shifts across the country, And this has implications for our families, who we marry, our work, our relationships, and the people we serve. Now, a few statistics. In the year 2000, 1/3 of the people in this country are what is termed people of color. And I want to speak about that term in just a moment. In the year 2014, half of the students in our nation's school were students of color. Now in Yakima, we're way past that halfway mark. We have schools here that are 80, 90% Hispanic, the tribal school, which is 100% tribal kids and so forth. But this is nationwide. And then in the year 2045, I won't be here, but that's not that far away. What is termed minority will be the majority in this country. And we've already passed that halfway mark in, I think, three states now, Texas, Arizona, New Mexico, perhaps. I'll have to look that up to be sure. The term people of color. I first heard this term in 1975. I was returning from a service project in the Dominican Republic, La República Dominicana. I had no idea what it meant. And I was told, black, white, yellow, I'm sorry, black, red, yellow, brown, everything but white. And I was told that this term, people of color, was actually, it was meant to counter the negative implications of non-white, which means you're a non, you're not, or minority, which means less than. And so I thought that was interesting because I had been in the Dominican Republic working in the interior of the country where everyone was black and the kids especially had never seen anyone with light colored skin like mine. So when we walked in, I think there were probably four or five of us, my husband included, all of us with light skin. We walked into their village and the kids all screamed and ran and hid behind the palm trees. And yeah, because they were seeing, does anybody know? They were seeing ghosts, but we had been forewarned. So we were ghosts with candy. And so little by little, the faces peeked out from behind the tree and the kids came out and they were gathered around us in a circle. And I was looking at a sea of beautiful brown faces. And the first little boy who came up to me went like this on my arm. And just think about, can you see this? He was rubbing on my arm like this and then looking at his hand. I was the person of color. Okay, so I use the term, even though it's not accurate, but I just want to make it clear that we all have a color. So a quick look at some of the demographic changes here in Washington State, and these are some of the school districts that we've worked with over the past few years. This is White Center, interestingly named, White Center, Washington, which is just south of Seattle. The largest population of new students are Somali refugees. And one of the teachers there told me that her class was filled with these kids who she was trying to teach English, grammar, spelling, commas, punctuation, when all of a sudden outside in the parking lot, there was some construction going on and a truck came by and there was a loud noise. And all the kids screamed and dove under their desks and refused to come out for the rest of the hour. So think about it. These are kids that have just seen, they've come to a country where they don't know anyone, they don't speak the language, the culture is completely different. Their villages were burned to the ground. For some of them, their families were killed in front of their eyes, and here they are in the school system. Just think about that if you're a teacher. Let me try that again. There it goes. This is in Kent, Washington, near the SeaTac Airport and near Seattle as well. Kent has students from over 138 language backgrounds. And I was amazed, how do you deal with that, teachers and administrators? When you walk into the school in the main entrance, there's this electronic box on a pedestal and it says, push here for English, push here for Spanish, push here for Swahili or whatever the language is, 138 of them in alphabetical order. And then the kids can come to school and hear the announcement of the day, or the parents can hear it in their own language. I'm looking forward to the day when we have one universal language, but we're not there yet. So Tukwila, Washington, also on the Seattle side, one of the most diverse school districts in the country. Take a look at the teacher, take a look at the flags and the kids. It's here, folks, already. Here we are. Tukwila was number one most diverse a couple of years ago. I think now it's moved down the list to about 45. So my thought is our diversity is the source of our greatest strength, and at the same time, some of our most divisive problems. We have obviously made a lot of progress over the years, and we still have a long way to go, with some of us marching for white supremacy and others for the right to breathe. I want to take a quick look now. Are we all okay so far? Am I going too fast, too slow, too boring? Okay, all right. In that case, I'll take that as a yes, I'm going to continue. So some common responses to diversity. And the first one, you may have heard of some of these terms before, is ethnocentrism. And that means my culture is the best. Our way is the right way. That's just the way we do things around here. And that ethnocentrism is what justified Manifest Destiny, Indian removal and genocide, slavery, and many other horrors. Ethnocentrism. The next is assimilation, which means I'm giving up my culture, I'm being absorbed into the dominant group, and you've all heard the idea of the melting pot. Sometimes this is voluntary, like my grandparents, when they came, they were white, and so they could do this, white European immigrants. They deliberately, on purpose, gave up their language, their music, their clothing, their holidays, most of their food, but my grandfather still liked to eat smelly sardines and Limburger cheese. But for the most part, gave up all of their culture and deliberately did not pass their language and traditions on to their children and became part of the American melting pot in a voluntary way, under pressure, admittedly, for reasons of survival. Other people were forced to melt, and Sherilyn mentioned the indigenous peoples in the Indian boarding schools where their hair was cut, they were beaten for speaking their language. They had to wear pioneer dresses and clothing. So assimilation can be voluntary or forced. And here we have the melting pot. Next is acculturation. And this means you are taking on elements of the new culture without giving up your own. So you have a foot in both worlds, which means you may be bicultural and bilingual. Another response to human diversity. Segregation, we've all heard that term. Again, segregation can be forced. I'm going to do all the talking because I know it's hard to The chat is off and it's hard to raise people's hands. We'll just take more time. So forced segregation, Chinese Exclusion Act, Japanese incarceration around World War II, Jim Crow, Native reservations, etc. And then if you can think of some types of voluntary segregation, and I would include some religious groups, Amish, Mennonites, and there's also white flight in gated communities, so where people deliberately take themselves out of the mainstream. Another response to diversity, and this is a term most people have not heard, I'm guessing, is bicultural ambivalence. And that's when you don't fit in either world. And maybe you were brought here as a child and you don't relate to your parents' culture, you don't speak the language, or you might be embarrassed by those other ways. And at the same time, the new larger dominant culture where you've moved into rejects you. And so you're not part of that either. So there's no center point. And that's that kind of empty space in the middle. And I would say many multiracial kids belong in that, or feel like they're in that center circle as well. My own two kids were born and raised in Puerto Rico, and they grew up speaking Spanish, eating Puerto Rican food, wearing Puerto Rican clothing, celebrating Puerto Rican holidays, and so forth, and all their friends were Puerto Rican. When we moved to the States, my husband and I were moving back home. Our kids were moving to a foreign country, and they definitely did not fit in here. And they were in that empty, hollow place for many, many years, and it caused a lot of difficulty. And many teachers have those kids from that background in their classes. And I'll spare you all the stories of their experiences. That would be a whole nother PowerPoint. So cultural relativism, this is a kind of a research term. It was an attempt to overcome the idea of ethnocentrism, which says my culture is the best one and the only important one. Relativism says all cultures are good and all cultures are right for the people in those cultures. So Japanese culture is the best culture for Japanese people. Arab culture is great for Arabs, but there's a problem with that. Do we really agree with every aspect of every other culture? Do we really believe in that Chinese foot binding is good for Chinese women, or that women should be, have their face covered in some Arab countries and not be allowed to drive or work outside the home? And there are many things in my own culture which I strongly disagree with and I feel are unjust and very materialistic and unfair. So, and at the same time, my views are shaped by my culture. So how can I really make judgments about the validity of other cultures? That's the problem with relativism. This is the one that our country, the United States, says that it is built upon pluralism or multiculturalism, which is coexistence, where each group is welcome and each group maintains its unique cultural identity within a shared majority cluster. Culture. I have other things on my mind here. It affirms the value of diversity, and we expect that each group has something to contribute to the larger society. So this is the idea, and you've heard this one, of the salad bowl rather than the melting pot. And that sounds reasonable, but this is the one that makes the most sense to me, and that's the idea of unity in diversity. And it's based on the recognition of the oneness of humanity. And just like a human body, each part has something important to contribute, and then all the parts function together as one organic whole. This is a paradigm shift from many centers to one. There is no us or them, it's all us. So this is true inclusion, as opposed to assimilating into the melting pot and getting rid of your culture. This strips away our diversity. This is where everyone is part of that one whole, but you notice now that the circles are not round. They're all stretched, and they've had to stretch and grow and maybe leave behind some things that don't fit for the good of all, and maybe adopt some new understandings and new ways of being so that all of us are included. And that stretching process is like a birth, and that can be painful. And I think that's where we are as humanity right now. The eye is an example of unity in diversity. The pupil admits light so we can see. The iris opens and closes the pupil to admit just the right amount of light. Each part has something important to contribute, and all the parts function together as one organic whole. What would happen if all the parts of the eye were the same? So Sherlyn, I'm going to ask if you would choose a reader for me. And this is from Black Elk, who is an Oglala Sioux medicine man, from the book Black Elk Speaks, where Black Elk dictated his thoughts. And it's The Sacred Hoop.
Okay, wow, I get to choose. Mm-hmm. All right, Chris, Billy.
thank you. The Sacred Hoop. I was seeing in a sacred manner the shapes of all things in the spirit. And I saw that the sacred hoop of my people was one of many hoops that made one circle. And in the center grew one mighty flowering tree to shelter all children of one mother and one father. And I saw that it was holy. Black Elk, Oglala, Sioux Medicine Man, 1863 to 1950, Black Elk Speaks.
Thank you, Chris. Oh, sorry.
No, sorry. Go ahead.
Thank you. Chris, I'm going to ask you if you read that last paragraph one more time and in the center.
Okay. And in the center grew one mighty flowering tree to shelter all children of one mother and one father. And I saw that it was holy.
Thank you. In my classes, I usually have people read the quotes twice because the first time it kind of goes whoosh, over your head and the second time it sinks into your heart. So I appreciate that. So another thing we do in our in-person classes, and it doesn't work on Zoom because the audio is asynchronous, but comparing it to many different notes that blend together in the making of a perfect chord. And we actually sing that chord in the class, and people get the idea of unity in diversity. So let me stop for just a moment and ask if there are any questions so far. And if there are, Sherilyn will call on you.
Yeah, just raise that participant hand if you do.
And if not, okay. Yep, go on.
I think so.
Okay, we want to take a look at some of the equity issues in our schools. And again, these are just some of the issues, some of the more common ones. So our schools, as I mentioned earlier, we face significant challenges related to race, gender, poverty, language, and many other dimensions of our diversity as well. So these are a few. One is biased curriculum. And I may have Sherilyn answer these questions. Sherilyn, I'm gonna pick on you. Or I can pick on Jillian or Nason, if you'd prefer. But I have a couple of questions about this. This is a quote taken out of my granddaughter's fourth grade textbook. Mm. And the quote says, Cortez found beautiful silver and gold treasures in the Aztec cities. So here's my question. What's wrong with this statement?
Wow.
Do you want to ask someone? Oh, I see Lorraine has
her. Yeah. Hand. Yeah, go ahead, Lorraine. You got it.
Oh, sorry. I didn't know what we were doing. Okay. What's wrong with this statement is he didn't find it. He stole it, came in, grabbed it.
Yeah, exactly. He didn't find. Like, oh, I was just walking along the beach and, oh, tripped over this rock. Oh, wow, it's gold. I found it. Finders keepers, right? No, he stole, raped, pillaged, murdered, you know, try a different word that would be more truthful.
Like tripping over a continent, right? We found America, tripped over the continent.
Right, exactly. So it's not, the word found sounds innocuous, right? It's not a swear word. It's not an ethnic slur. It doesn't sound bad, but it carries a lot of meaning. Mm-hmm. And that is everywhere throughout our curriculum. It's hiding the truth. So here's another question. And maybe I could pick on Lorraine again, because Lorraine, you got that right away. This, who is invisible in this statement?
The people, the Aztec people.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
The people who owned the gold.
Exactly. So, and I had an interesting talk with my granddaughter when she had this assignment. And I hope, you know, she went back to school with a different perspective than her textbook. I read through that entire chapter and there was not one mention of the indigenous people. And in fact, it said things like, you know the old one, Columbus discovered America. And then the pioneers came and settled in an empty, endless stretch of land, Their main dangers were, rocky mountains and harsh weather and, wild animals. Not even a mention of the people who were already there. Thought that was interesting. Here's another one. Let's see, everyone can do this because you don't have to raise your participant hand. You can just raise your hand. So no, this is a non-speaking part. So take a look at the words, the names on the left, and raise your hand if you know all or almost all of those names. Raise your hand. Okay, it looks like most of us. Okay, now take a look at this list on the right and raise your hand if you know all or almost all of these names. I see Anne and Julia. I'm impressed. Okay. What's the difference? And Sherlyn, maybe I can ask you, what's the difference between the list on the left and the list on the right?
Well, I know Ella Baker, so so I'm going to say that the list on the right are people of color who have made significant contributions to civilization.
That would be a very good guess. That would be a good guess. And Ella Baker is of African descent. Mm-hmm. But
not that all of them are necessary.
But not all of them. No.
Not all.
She's the only one. I do have a different slide, and we don't have it tonight. But it's
gender.
Names of people of African descent. Regina.
It's gender.
Gender. Absolutely gender. The left is all what? Regina.
Men.
And on the right?
Women.
All women. Exactly. Now, would it surprise you to learn that everyone on the right did exactly the same things as everyone on the left, but farther or faster or first?
Ooh.
Okay. And we can go over the details later if you have questions. Remember yeah. slide 35 if you want to come back to that later.
It's a great list.
Yeah. So interesting. I love making lists like that. Okay. So, did you see that? Our history. What? Look at the top.
Yes.
Our history and heritage. We get the first half in school. And the second half, nowhere. Mm-hmm. Goodbye. Another equity issue in our schools is discriminatory discipline. And repeated studies over and over again show significantly harsher punishments for students of color and low-income students, and also students with disabilities, beginning in preschool for the exact same offense. Think about that. What is at play here? Here's another, the school to prison pipeline. How many have heard of that? Yes, no, a lot of us. This is called by PBS an epidemic that is plaguing schools across the nation. And that's a whole nother presentation in itself, but it's one of the issues, a serious one. Another is segregated schools. Did you know that decades after Brown versus the Board of Education, which said school segregation is illegal, that public schools are more segregated now than they were when that decision was handed down by the Supreme Court? And there are reasons for that. Part of that is growing Hispanic enrollment, like in my town, for example, resistance to integration, white flight, and racial steering, where realtors have told white families, let me show you homes in this area. And they'll say, well, what about this house? I really like that house. And they say, well, that's not a safe neighborhood, or those aren't good schools. You'd be much better off here. And that's extremely common. That happened to me, my family, when we moved here to Yakima 30 years ago. Every realtor office that I went in looking for a home, I said, we've got two kids. We need, so many bedrooms. We need to be close to, school within, easy driving distance, et cetera, et cetera. And I added, and we've just moved here from Puerto Rico, and my kids speak Spanish, so I'd like to find a neighborhood where they can keep up their Spanish skills, and you know, be really happy to find a diverse neighborhood with people of all different backgrounds. And every single realty office showed me the door. Think about that. So we bought a house, which was a good thing, because in the end, we ended up buying a house that was a whole lot cheaper because it was for sale by owner. So I guess there was a silver lining there. Unequal resources. So this is pretty standard. High, and I put the word in quotes, high minority schools, high poverty schools tend to have less money per student and larger class sizes, less experienced, lower paid teachers who are teaching out of their field of study, dangerous or outdated facilities, less demanding curriculum, higher staff turnover, and what is termed by the US Department of Education, a massive inequity in resources. Unconscious bias, this is by teachers, those of us who are in the schools working with students. Did you know that students with black sounding names like Jamal get lower test scores than those with white sounding names like Jake for the exact same answers? Now, obviously not on multiple choice tests, but where you have to write in your answer, okay? Lots of research over and over again bears this out. And another, racial bullying. Over 1 in 5 students between the ages of 12 and 18 report being bullied at school. That's a fifth of our student population. And it includes being made fun of, called names, insulted, excluded from activities, sometimes forced to do things that you don't want to do, pushed, tripped, spit on, your property's destroyed, or threatened with serious harm. And then in recent years, add cyberbullying to the list as well.
Could I just add that those are only those that report it?
Exactly, thank you. Absolutely. Yeah. That number is probably a whole lot higher. Mm-hmm. It, undoubtedly a whole lot higher. Thank you for that. Colorblind racism. Many of us have been taught that it's wrong to notice skin color, but we aren't really colorblind. And most of the teachers that I work with and administrators, and they'll say this when we had in-person trainings, they would say this on the very first day when I put up colorblindness, just the title of the slide. And they say, colorblind racism, colorblind isn't racist, it's just the opposite. I'm colorblind. And I say, can you explain that? Do you have a problem with your vision? You know, have you been to the eye doctor? No, I'm colorblind in the classroom. That means I don't see color. I treat everyone as an individual. And my thought is, it is well-intentioned, but if we say, I don't see color, it denies people's lived experience and it makes them invisible. Now, what if someone came up to me and said, Randy, I don't see you as a woman. I'm gender blind. Well, excuse me. That's how I go through life. That's how other people see me. That's how they treat me. And you can't see that? And if we can't see race, we can't see racism. Think about that. I would say it's better to see and value diversity, not to be colorblind, but color aware and prejudice free. So if you take one thing from this presentation today, this is it. I believe that we won't make significant progress as a community or as a nation until we find unity in all of our diversity, until we recognize that there is no us or them. It's all us. Think about that. So are we okay so far, or are you ready to hear a little bit about the UnityWorks school program? Questions, comments, keep going, bring out the dessert. Okay, I'm gonna
keep going.
All right, so the UnityWorks school program. UnityWorks is a nonprofit. Sherilyn mentioned this at the beginning, and we are a nonprofit educational organization committed to a belief in the oneness of humanity, the value of diversity, and the need for unity. Oops. Oh, sorry. Let me go back. Our mission is to promote cross-racial and cross-cultural understanding, equity, and inclusion with a focus on K-12 schools. We have deliberately chosen to work with educators because of the multiplier effect. A single teacher can reach thousands of students over the course of a career. And then those students can then influence their families, their neighborhoods, their workplaces, and their communities for generations to come. We have particularly worked to address what is called the most vital and challenging issue of racial prejudice, and to develop a social action model that will translate this vision of unity into reality and action. So UnityWorks began in 2014, about 8 years ago, on the Yakima Nation Reservation in Washington State. And our national headquarters is in my upstairs bedroom. And it has developed into a proven model, which includes professional development training for educators, high quality, at least I hope they're high quality, definitely low cost educational resources, and ongoing support through our K-12 school program, which I will share with you a little bit in a moment, but know that right now it is on hold due to the pandemic. For the past 2 years, we've had nothing in person at all. The program is not a specific curriculum or a top-down list of multicultural directives that must be implemented at each school. Rather, it's a set of principles, tools, and strategies designed to build capacity at the grassroots, empowering each team to create its own blueprint for change. And these are three of our school administrators here in Yakima from three different schools. A network of teams creates a learning community that can share ideas and resources, build confidence, and offer support. And when before the pandemic, the teams met together at the end of each school year for a multicultural conference where they shared what they were doing and some of their challenges, some of their successes, and so forth. I missed that. Questions so far, or would you like to hear about the Summer Training Institute? Summer Training Institute coming right up. Okay. So in the summer, when teachers are off school, that's when they're free, we have involvement in the school program begins with an action-packed 5-day, that's 40 hours, very intensive summer training institute. And that's designed to prepare school site teams with the knowledge, tools, and strategies needed to develop a diversity action plan, which they then would carry out during the school year. And UnityWorks would meet with them from time to time, do site visits, if they wanted to bounce ideas off of us, or, hey, this incident just happened on campus, how do we handle it? Or do you have any resources for Columbus Day? Oh, now it's Indigenous Day here in Washington State, okay. So just ongoing support with their plan. High school and college students have participated in the training as well. And the sessions are interactive, hands-on, and have real life classroom applications. Here you see a counselor on the left, Charles, and one of the administrators doing a stereotyping activity where they're writing down stereotypes on little post-it notes and posting them up on different categories of people around the room. And then we discuss those common stereotypes, which we hear in schools and which everybody knows anyway, all the time. And we talk about how to get them out of here. Training topics include race and racism, culture, language, gender, religion, stereotyping, prejudice, equality versus equity, school discipline, culturally responsive teaching, and a whole lot more. These are students at the Yakima Nation Tribal School. Guest speakers each day serve to personalize the training content by sharing stories and answering questions about their own lives. And the participants have said that this is the highlight of their day. getting to know a real person and their life story. It's not abstract after that. With singing, dancing, drama, poetry, crafts, and other arts activities, the training is also a lot of fun. And then our former spring multicultural conference, which I hope we will be able to reestablish again once the pandemic is far in the rearview mirror. Where local coordination is in place, activities such as this conference can provide opportunities for teams to network and share best practices. We are not just providing goods and services, but intentionally building local capacity. And our goal is not only to change laws and policies, although that's certainly part of it, but hearts and minds. So next, a few, we'll try to do, it's a little harder on Zoom, but we'll try to do a couple of sample training activities. I've got three of them here. This one is called Link Ups. It's on our Teaching Unity curriculum guide. And all of these are in our classroom materials. So I'm going to start and say that you can do this in your classroom. You can do it with kids, you can do it with adults, you can do it with study circles. So I'm starting. Hi, my name is Randie, and I love to play volleyball. So raise your hand, anyone else in the Zoom here like to play volleyball? Anybody? Okay, Sherlyn, I see your hand. Okay, so Sherlyn and I would link arms. It's hard to show you on the Zoom, but we would link arms and both standing at the front of the classroom. And then Sherlyn would describe the link. She would say, this is Randie and I'm Sherlyn and we both like to play volleyball. So Sherlyn, go ahead and do that. Unmute.
All right. Well, this is Randie and I'm Sherlyn and we both like to play volleyball.
And now you're gonna add something. Go ahead.
Okay. I like to play the flute. Okay.
Any other flute players in here? Raise your hands. Okay, let's just say no one raised their hands. So you're going to have to.
We got one.
Is there one? I can't see it, but.
Yes, okay. Remy and Dave. Awesome.
Okay, so then Sherlyn would call on one of them if there's two or three or more. And then that person would come up and link arms with Sherlyn and on until I do it with the whole classroom. But when I'm demonstrating it for the teacher training, we just do it with five or six people so they get the idea of how it works. So then you have the entire classroom is linked together, arm in arm, and then the last person has to think of something that they can link back to the first person. So it might be, and I have a pet cat, okay? And so let's say the first person has a pet cat, they can come and link arms. If not, they have to think of something else until they link. And then that closes the circle. So the cool thing about this is that every single person in the room has made at least two connections with two other people in the room. And that making connections is what it's all about. Mm-hmm. So this is a cool get to know you activity at the start of the school year or the start of anything. So this is another one. This is a jar. And let me grab my jar here. So can y'all see this? This is a wide mouth jar. Don't try it with a narrow mouth jar. So top comes off easy, standard jar, right? Then I'll call someone up. Let me show you one of the, let me get back here. Okay, hang on a second. Here we go. So this is one of the participants in our trainings. And here's the jar, and I say, can you just take the top off of this jar? But there's a catch. You can use four fingers, but you can't use your thumb. So you can see she's kind of got her thumb out of the way there. You see the picture. So she's struggling, and she can't open it. And then I say, okay, now try it with your thumb. Oh, simple, okay? So any biology or science majors in here? Now, what do we call our thumbs? Anybody?
Opposable thumb?
Opposable digit.
Yes, it's opposable, which means opposite, right? Try it with your hand. It moves in the opposite direction, which gives us the ability to do what, Sherlyn? grasp, right? So diversity gives us options. It gives us choices. It gives us strength. It gives us creativity. Diversity is not the problem. Diversity is the solution. Now, don't try this as I did once. I try to pick out someone in the class, usually female, no stereotyping here, usually female, short, with very thin fingers, just to make sure they have a problem. One time I made the mistake of calling on this giant linebacker football type guy, and he took two fingers and went like this, boop, and popped it off. So that's the last time I tried that one. Okay. Diversity is not the problem. Diversity is the solution. Now, here's one more. I'm going to need a volunteer for this. If Sherlyn, if you'd like to pick someone who is not colorblind, raise your hand.
Okay, who's not colorblind? Raise your hand if you're not colorblind. Okay, Jillian, you're not, you said you weren't colorblind. Jillian's been picked here.
Okay, thank you, Jillian. Are you ready? So we're going to... we do this actually in person. Let me see, I brought some of my paper colors here. So just regular construction paper. Can everybody see that? Different colors, black, white, red, yellow, and brown. So we have construction color paper. And depending on who's in the class, we might use real people, or just in case, I always bring along some photographs of people from different colors, different backgrounds. So here's what this person needs to do. The volunteer, or you, sometimes they're voluntold, but thank you, Jillian. So match the papers to the faces according to skin color. So I'll do the first one. So this is Lilita. She's the daughter of one of my neighbors. And this brownish, tannish paper, we'll say, is about the same color as Lilita's skin, okay? So Jillian, are you ready? Which is closer? Black or brown?
I guess brown. Definitely.
Yep. Which is closer, white or brown?
Brown.
Good. Which is closer, red or brown?
Brown.
Which is closer, yellow or brown?
Brown.
Okay, you got it. So what does this tell us about society's... You're off the hook, Jillian. You did great. Thank you. What does this tell us about society's color coding of human beings? It's a lie. We are just different shades of hue, man. And our colors are a lot closer than we've been taught to believe. Think about that. In fact, friends, there is no skin color border. We come in a continuum of hues and shades. So I want to share a couple of quotes from the teachers who have gone through this training, not just this last slide, but the whole week-long training. And Sherlyn, could you pick four readers for us?
Okay, Vince is first, then Scott, then Lucinda, and then Vera.
Perfect, thank you. So this is Alejandra Rodriguez. She's an assistant principal, and she said,
I became an educator to help others. UnityWorks has given us the tools. It's definitely a need. We have to address the issues, and now we know how.
Thank you. And Craig Olden, who's a school counselor.
I came in here with an intellectual lens. Through the experiences this week, it's gone from my brain to my heart. Wow.
That really moved me. Thank you.
Yeah.
And then Joy Mendoza, who's a high school student in town.
UnityWorks opened my eyes. Even though I'm young, I can make a difference. Others say I can't, but I can.
Others say I can't, but I can. That's very powerful. Thank you. And the last one, this is Edith Godinez, and she works at Educational Service District 105, which provides training and computer services to about 45 districts in the Central Washington area. And she's an advocate for marginalized youth.
Because of this training, my hope in humanity will never be lost.
Thank you. Mm. That this is why I'm doing this, friends, because it just, you can see people change. Yeah. Questions so far, or would you like to hear some highlights from the school program? Continue? Questions?
Continue, it looks like.
Continue, okay. So this is our, this is our UnityWorks school program, which, as I said, currently it's been on hold for 2 years now, and I miss it because of the pandemic. All of our schools were closed. And there, some of them are back, many of them are still hybrid, but no large meetings. So a wide variety of programs and activities have been organized by the UnityWorks teams, including, and I'm going to share a few from high school, then middle school, and then elementary school level. So one high school took a look at its data on achievement gaps between racial groups and decided to provide diversity training for all of their staff. They said, wow, there's a huge gap here. What are we going to do about it? And so based on the training that they took with us, the week-long UnityWorks Summer Institute, they developed monthly lessons on stereotyping, prejudice, race, and culture for all students. And if you look at this map, this shows you, they actually had a gigantic map, which they posted in the school cafeteria, and teachers came by and put stars on the map where their particular ancestors had come from, all of the ancestors that they knew. Then they made another map right next to it, and they put, they had students come up and put stars on it all for them, for all the students. And they were just amazed at the difference. And all the teachers, largely from Western Europe, and almost all of the students from Central and South America and Mexico, and also from the Far East as well. So that told them right away, you know, there's a lot that we don't know about our students. So it's a good point. Yeah. They also organized an international students cultural fair, and this the students put this on themselves, made all of the pictures and maps. They even had food from their country. And then the UnityWorks team gave all the parents and community members who came in blank pages of a passport. And then they would go to each of these different booths for each of the different countries that the students were from and get a passport, a stamp in their passport. So it was kind of cool. It was a lot of fun. They also arranged for an all-school learning event with Lakota hoop dancer Kevin Locke. And his presentation, which was very well received, reached over 2,000 students. And his focus was on the oneness of humankind. And you see in this photo on the right here, this is Kevin holding up the hoops of humanity. And as he explained, each hoop, there's red, yellow, black, and white. And he said, each of those hoops represents a different race, a different color. And we know that race is a social construct today. Well, not everybody knows that, but a lot of people know that. And he said, each of these hoops represents a different race, different color of people. What would happen if we removed one of the hoops? And one girl volunteered, she came up and he said, any hoop you want, pull it out. She pulled out the hoop and the whole thing collapsed. And Kevin said, you see what I'm talking about? It's all of us or none of us. I thought that was really cool. And from Sharon Harris, the assistant principal at the time, she said, I feel confident that we are headed in the right direction. At another high school, the UnityWorks team organized an exhibit on African-American history, which was completely missing from their textbooks. No surprise there, right? And students also formed a multicultural club dedicated to learning about each other and serving the local community. And the student on the left, Alejandro Rodriguez, in the pink shirt, he was actually at our training. Teachers, his school team of adults invited him to come to the week-long training. And we let them bring students as long as they're mature, because we talk about some very difficult topics. And he said, you know, I'm a science major and I was going to form a computer club, but after this training, I decided to form a multicultural club instead. And he did. And there you see it sitting right in front of you. And the first thing they did was find out about the backgrounds and the culture and the life stories of every single person in the club. And then they decided to find out about the local community. And I thought it was kind of interesting that This was at a time when there was a Muslim ban. Some of you remember that, national Muslim ban. And Muslim people were being harassed and some were even being killed. And they decided the first thing they were going to do is visit the local mosque. Well, I've been in Yakima for 30 years. I didn't even know we had a local mosque. So I learned something from this club. They went to visit the mullah and they said, "We hear all these negative things about Islam and all Arabs are terrorists and blah, blah, blah. We are here to learn. What can you tell us about Islam and the Muslim faith?" And they spent the whole afternoon with him. And then they came back and shared that with their student clubs and completely changed people's understanding. I thought that was awesome. And then they decided to have a winter clothing drive and they went to visit the homeless shelter and just kept making up things to do to help make our community a better place. The power of youth. Now we're at the middle school level. And I include this example not because it's spectacular and amazing and hard to do, but because it's so simple and quick and easy. One middle school displayed posters highlighting diversity. And they did that to put images in people in the students' minds in order to create a more inclusive school environment. It cost them all of about $5, just a couple of posters. And my response to them wasn't, "That's all you're gonna do? Like, that's not gonna change anything." My response, and I truly feel this way, is, "That's awesome. You've taken a step down this path. Now, what's your next step?" Right? Another middle school, and this one was amazing. They were concerned that only 5 parents had participated in anything at all during the previous school year. So they set the goal of increasing parent and community involvement. And those of you who are educators and probably parents as well know that parent participation correlates directly with school achievement for kids in school. The more parents participate, the better that kid is going to do on average. And if parents are absent, they're missing a major pillar of support. So that was the reason why this middle school was so concerned. In consultation with the local families, they decided to do this by learning about the cultures represented in their school. The staff, students, and parents working in teams, they had 5 different teams, one for each racial or ethnic group by their definition of that group. They worked together to prepare a year-end cultural celebration. And each month, the teams grew in size and excitement as they studied their own history, geography, cultural traditions, religious beliefs, current struggles, and a lot more. Speaking through an interpreter, that's the one on the left, one parent described the joy, and look at her face, the joy that she felt at finally being included. The plan was a success, with participants growing from only 5 parents at the start of the year to over 450 at their culminating activity. That's amazing. And the assistant principal, Julio Sanchez, said, "We've been improving the program for 4 years now and have been making progress towards our goals every year." So I'm really excited by that. And now at the elementary level, this school created a unity wall with changing displays and organized a No Room in My Heart for Prejudice art and essay contest. And you can see, I don't know if you can, if it's large enough to see, but these 2 women, a school counselor and a librarian, are posting pictures of all the students in the school in these rays coming out from the heart. And they deliberately did not put them by alphabetical order or by classroom. They deliberately put a Black student next to a white student, next to a Native student, next to a Mexican student, and so forth, on purpose. And the first assignment to the students was, go find your own picture, and then go find the 2 people on either side of you and make a friend. I thought that was pretty ingenious. Another school researched countries and cultures from around the world and presented their findings to a standing room only audience of parents and community members. And the way they researched it, and you can see the bus on the right, this is Mrs. Frizzle's magic school bus. And it could go anywhere in the world at the blink of an eye. And so they went and they, whoops, let me go back one. Ah. Don't go away. Nope, back one more. Aha, okay. I have a new Zoom set up here, so I'm not used to where everything is at the moment. I was impressed because almost everyone in the audience, it was a standing room only audience, I did mention that, almost everyone was Spanish speaking as their first language. And the teachers obviously knew that. And so they had two narrators, one for English and one for Spanish. And the Spanish one went first. And I didn't know they were going to do this. So I was just blown away when the Spanish one, Spanish narrator, the student, got up and said, somos una sola familia humana y fuimos a visitar nuestros hermanos y hermanas alrededor del mundo. We are one human family. And we just went to visit our brothers and sisters all around the world. They had gone from us and them to oneness. They also created student artwork to illustrate the concept of unity and diversity. And I know you can't see this up close, but each one of those kids, it's a photo of the kids in that class. And that's the classroom. This elementary campus held an all-school assembly where students shared what they had been learning about Martin Luther King and the civil rights movement all semester. And they even invited, they had a speaker, and you can see him standing behind the person at the podium, who is a school board member and had, as a child, had been at the Martin Luther King marches and had met him in person. So that was kind of cool. Another school, and this is probably my favorite story, they were deeply concerned about a sharp increase in racial name calling and bullying. And this happened right after the last presidential election. I will not mention any names, but kids were coming to school using the N-word, pushing kids of color. They were in fights, and it was getting worse and worse. And the incidents were up in double digits and growing by the day. So their UnityWorks team was quite concerned and weren't sure exactly what to do until the principal said, it was the first week of school. I was standing on the schoolyard during recess and there were two students standing right in front of me, two girls. And one of them said to the other one, my parents won't let me play with you anymore because you are the color of poop. And I'm like, oh my God. So they said, our UnityWorks plan for this year is going to be learning about skin color. So they successfully eliminated these incidents and completely changed the school culture through a series of lessons on race and skin color. And for their culminating activity, and you see it right in front of you, 50 staff and over 700 students painted their own self-portraits using accurate skin colors and displayed these in hallways throughout the school. As a direct result, incidents of racial bias went from double digits to zero and stayed there for the rest of the school year. So friends, why did that happen? Every single student of every single color and every staff member, every teacher was validated for who they were. Every color was good. It was worthy of posting on the wall. Kids even brought their parents in and said, look, you know, there's my picture. This is my class. These are my friends. Very different than what had been happening just a few weeks prior to this activity. And at the end of the school year, during our spring conference, the principal got up and presented their activity and what they had done. And she said, we are now a community. I love this. And friends, all it costs was $100 for multicultural paint. It is not out of reach. Another principal, Alan Matsumoto, also created, and he's the one from the school that had the magic school bus. He created what's called the UnityWorks Minute, where at each staff meeting, a teacher is asked to share one activity that they have done with their students to promote unity and inclusion. So they're all learning from each other. And then just a couple more on the school program. And some of the schools decided, well, this is so cool. Next year, let's work together on this project. And so a number of collaborative programs rose up. This high school partnered with a local elementary school on an art board project where students work together to research and present on authors and artists from around the world. And the biographies were written in English and Spanish to support students' bilingual schools. Now, you have to know a little bit about Yakima, where if you, prior to this, if you would be sitting in the teacher's lounge or, you know, out in the parking lot where teachers were talking, they would, you would hear things like, if they want to speak Spanish, let them go back to Mexico. This is quite a different approach. And another group, three schools here, worked together to bring in a dramatic presentation, a play on the Japanese internment. And following the performance, the actors asked the audience, which were students, teachers, and community members, they asked them three questions. Why were people removed from their homes and imprisoned? Could something like this happen today? And what can you do about it? So I wanted to share a very short 2-minute video of educators who are sharing their thoughts, just a quick excerpt about the program. So I think Nason will let me know if the sound is okay. I hope it is. If not, I will fix it.
The UnityWorks project is a fundamental piece of helping build a better society, in my point of view. To do the projects, to do the thinking, to do the creative work that builds peace.
Ah, I'm sorry. I have to go back here.
Is really important to start in childhood. It's important to do this work with kids. It's also important to do this work with adults that are working in schools.
I think UnityWorks is an opportunity for us to begin relating to each other, not as the categories that we represent, such as which race we are, what our socioeconomic status is, whether or not we're male or female, anything like that, but rather as people who all have hopes and dreams of somehow living a better life and having that life being possible for our children and our community.
It's a way of us validating every single student we serve, despite what their ethnicity or their upbringing may be. I think it's an inclusionary program that just makes me as a teacher feel good, even about myself, you know, teaching them Black history or other kinds of just knowledge of how our world works and all the people and the cultures that have come to build our world.
Part of our jobs as teachers and educators is to tell them that there really is only one human race. And we have lots of cultures, but we really have only one human race. And that's why I think UnityWorks is so vital for our community and other communities in our world.
There's a proverb, a African proverb, that says if you want to go fast, you go alone. And if you want to go far, you go together. And I believe that this is why UnityWorks is important, because we want to go far. And in order to do that, we need to work together. And so that's why UnityWorks is important.
Okay.
The UnityWorks.
Oh, there we go. Sorry about that. Okay, so we're getting close to the end. I wanted to share before we open for questions. I think I have 5 readers for this one, Sherlyn. Teachers changing views on race.
Okay, I really want to go for folks that don't have their faces on to draw you out, but that's just my slightly diabolical side. Oh, I see Kate Vesely's here. Kate, you're number 1. Sid, you're number 2. Gladys, number 3. These are folks that are just now coming on screen. Awesome, awesome. Let me see if I can get someone from the next screen. And let's see. Okay. Deanna is 4. And Jill, 5.
Thank you, Sherlyn.
So, thank you, friends.
Yes, and just so you know, I usually ask people on the first day when they come into the class to write down on a 3x5 card without their name, how many races do you think there are? And it usually starts with five, like black, white, red, yellow, brown. Or sometimes it'll be 7 or 10 or 25 or 82. I've even had numbers up into the thousands. And then we share those cards, pass them around. So, and you're not reading your own card, but just put them in a hat and then draw them out, draw a card out of the hat and read the number. So we get an idea of what the class is thinking without anyone's name attached to that number. So this this is at the end of the class, what people are saying. So number one reader.
I never really thought of there being only one race. You really don't get taught that anywhere in life. So when you hear it for the first time, it kind of baffles you.
Thank you. And this one is from Susan.
The readings about race really opened my eyes. I always thought of race as black, white, red, and yellow, and that color blindness was good. Now I see that inclusion and awareness are better than just seeing people as all the same. I like the flower garden idea. I've never thought of it any of it that way, appreciating each individual flower for its own beauty.
Thank you. And Brock says,
Gladys, that's you. Are you there, Gladys?
Sorry, I was muted. When we were told there was only one race, it took me a minute to realize that we are all one race, the human race. It was so simple to understand. As an educator, I must give my students the same awareness before they believe in our society's highly biased view. And it's too late.
Thank you, Gladys. And from Patrick.
The fact that this can be supported by science only confirms the prejudice of our past. How are children supposed to understand what is right and wrong when parents and teachers as role models are programming racist ideology at such an early age?
And we have one more from Nicole.
That's you, Jill.
I learned today that we are one race, and I'm going to educate that we are one race. This idea makes me think of the movie Independence Day, when aliens came to blow us up, and we as humans came together as one to fight off violence. Someday, I would like to see that happen without the aliens.
Thank you. So thank you, readers. I appreciate that help. Just a quick overview of some of the diversity resources that we've developed in response to teacher requests. And one is a Teaching Unity Toolkit, which is a curriculum guide with hands-on learning activities. And that's for the upper elementary age level. And I'm excited to share that this is in classrooms around the world. Another is Overcoming Prejudice. It's just a two-page PDF download for parents and teachers. Just gives a few ideas to get us started. We have some colorful PowerPoints for kids, mostly pictures, but using age-appropriate language to learn about skin color, prejudice, and how to overcome it. And this one, Portraits of Humanity, it's color photos of our brothers and sisters from around the world, which will look great on your office or classroom wall. And then lots of other things available on our website for those who are interested.